Okay, this is something that I'm probably going to be getting some flack for, so before I go on, please like the video and share it, and also subscribe to the channel. But in any case, we're going to talk a little bit about the issues of censorship arising out of hate crimes. And when I say hate crimes, I'm not using a legal term that I really believe should be sustainable. A hate crime is something that implies that the motive of the person should add on to the sentence, okay? I think it's very difficult to establish really if people's motives are really the underlying, their prejudices are the things that cause them to be violent people, okay? I would say that people's prejudices cause them to take out other frustrations that they have on people that they hate. But let's dive into it. You have, and this is a moment that I think is really not good for Israel and its diplomat, its ambassador to the UN, Danny Danone, who I think it's fortunate that he's not the ambassador for them to the United States. So full disclosure, I am former IDF, so don't claim, I am not anti-Israel. I am not here to talk about the Israel issue. I'm here to talk about the topic today, which is censorship, as well as legal repercussions from the synagogue shooting over in Poway. I think it's pronounced Poway. And Israel's ambassador to the UN says that the only way to stop anti-Semitism is to criminalize it. He says the time for talking and having a conversation is over. Danone said, what Israel and the Jewish community around the world demand is action, and now. So I want to ask, really, what is the real solution to that? How do you criminalize something that people believe? It can't be done. It's the same argument I say to people who say that, well, we should ban Islam. If people convert to Islam while they're here and they're U.S. citizens, what are you supposed to do about them? Are you going to negate their citizenship? Those people who believe things like that, okay, and I'm not saying I'm the first person who will stand up for people who criticize Islam, who criticize religions, who criticize atheism, who criticize anything. I am, definitely in favor of freedom of speech for anyone, and I think freedom of speech is really the solution to most of the problems that are going on with topics like these. Now, he says, from the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh to the Chabad Synagogue in Poway, California, anti-Semitism is no longer a fringe bigotry in the U.S., Danone said. Then, as now, all the right people are saying all the right things. They express their sympathies and call for an end to this violence and bigotry. It seems that we have learned nothing from the Pittsburgh attack, and we are likely to continue to do nothing following the attack in San Diego, Danone continued. He added that since October, members of Congress have openly exposed themselves as anti-Semites, and that the New York Times cartoon could have been taken from the head of the pages of Der Stürmer, the Nazi propaganda paper. And yet these actions have gone unpunished, Danone said. I have not seen the New York Times hold anyone accountable for this horrible cartoon. When you have pictures, cartoons, words, and demonstrations, it leads to violence and shootings. So this is the now, I actually collaborate with a channel called The Hard Bastard, the guy who runs it is pretty much, he will say anything, okay? He is no filter, and it's all about anti-censorship. And that's the reason that I write for his organization, because it is anti-censorship. But the things that he says are pretty far out there, because many of the things he says in humor. And many of the things he says in order to, he's a shock jock. So what am I supposed to do about people who are, you know, what they want to do is to say that the things that you say are causing acts of violence. And this is the same topic that's going on right now. If you haven't seen, there's a Netflix show that is now tied. In fact, let's go to 13 Reasons Why. So there's massive, there's a suicide epidemic apparently that is being associated with it. And some are saying, well, Netflix should have never aired it, and they bear some responsibility with it. Now, I think that's a little besides the point. This is the third time I'm shooting a video or commenting on this today. I just haven't been able to upload a version that I like. So let's move back to the issue. You also have Rabbi Shmuley Boteach, who is claiming that he's calling it the Old York Times, in, you know, connoting the city of York in England, which expelled its Jews in the 12th century. So they are talking mostly about this cartoon. Let me actually pull it up. So here's another blog that these people actually support the New York Times. It's Richard Silverstein. He says it's not anti-Semitic at all. So this is the cartoon over here. And the fact is that when you put a yarmulke on top of his head, yes, it is. It has nothing to do with Judaism. It has nothing to do with Zionism. It has everything to do with Judaism. Okay? So then he's asking why nobody is complaining about Eli Valley's cartoon over here, where you have Trump with the Nazi armband being clearly hugged by Benjamin Netanyahu. Well, I would say that I don't even think that didn't appear in the New York Times. So that's not really a good response from this guy, Richard Silverstein, who I think is, he calls his blog Tikkun Olam, but it is kind of, Tikkun Olam is a fake concept of progressivism in Judaism, by the way. Tikkun Olam is, there's actually a whole book about it. I've done a video about that, I think. So there are people within the Jewish community who would say that this is not anti-Semitism. I am giving you my opinion here. When you put a yarmulke on the head of the president of the United States and say he's being led astray by Benjamin Netanyahu as his dachshund guide dog, that's anti-Semitic. I mean, the yarmulke has nothing to do with Zionism. It's a Jewish symbol. Okay? And it's ableist, too. A blind man? Don't you think, New York Times, if you're going to go by those progressive standards, why are you making fun of the blind in your publication? But back to the commentators, Alan Dershowitz, who happens to be feuding with Shmuley Boteach, also ties the cartoon to the shooting in California. And I want to make something very clear here. Alan Dershowitz and Shmuley Boteach, the one time that they agree, they happen to be completely wrong, okay? And the fact is that this appeared in the International Edition. There is no evidence that this gunman even saw the cartoon. So I'm sorry for you guys. There are times when people saying or doing things anti-Semitic is, you know, you can object to it. I certainly am not happy when it happens, but it is not a hate crime. It doesn't cause hate crimes unless you can prove that the gunman or the offender, whoever it happens to be, for whatever the crime is, you have to prove that it was, in fact, a motivating factor, that cartoon was a motivating factor for the crime that you're talking about. Otherwise, I don't want to hear anything about this being an incitement to act of anti-Semitism until I see an actual connection between the two. Okay, now for the issue of why you can't have a law that regulates anti-Semitism or hate speech of any type. And this is a very easy thing to look up. There's this site called OYES. I don't know if it's OYES, OYES, whatever, but it lists all of the major Supreme Court cases in a very summarized format. And you have here, this is Brandenburg versus Ohio. I believe that, so yeah, it was argued in 1969 and decided the same year. And it says, Brandenburg, a leader in the Ku Klux Klan, made a speech at a Klan rally and was later convicted under an Ohio criminal syndicalism law. The law made illegal advocating crime, sabotage, violence, or unlawful methods of terrorism as a means of accomplishing industrial or political reform, as well as assembling with any society, group, or assemblage of persons formed to teach or advocate the doctrines of criminal syndicalism. So what they were trying to say was that the Ku Klux Klan is a criminal organization, and therefore there is no right of assembly at all for people belonging to the Ku Klux Klan. So it's the question was, did Ohio's criminal syndicalism law prohibiting public speech that advocates various illegal activities violate Brandenburg's right to free speech as protected by the First and 14th Amendment? So this was a per curiam opinion, meaning that every single judge on the court, including, by the way, Thurgood Marshall, the first black justice on the Supreme Court, and William O. Douglas, who is one of the most liberal justices in the history of the court, and not to mention Earl Warren, they all reached the opinion that, yes, it was a violation. The court's per curiam opinion held that the Ohio law violated Brandenburg's right to free speech. The court used a two-pronged test to evaluate speech acts. One, speech can be prohibited if it is directed at inciting or producing imminent lawless action. And two, it is likely to incite or produce such action. The Criminal Syndicalism Act made illegal the advocacy and teaching of doctrines while ignoring whether or not that advocacy and teaching would actually incite imminent lawless action. The failure to make this distinction rendered the law overly broad and in violation of the Constitution. Here's case two, okay? This is National Socialist Party of America versus Village of Skokie. It is a fairly well-known case for almost any civil liberties lawyer, which I'm not, but you can ask them, or any person who's familiar with civil liberties law in America, even a casual observer like me, who's making stupid YouTube videos. It was decided in 1977, okay? And these Nazis wanted to demonstrate in a public park in Skokie, and the village of Skokie wanted to. Skokie is in it's north of Chicago, I believe. So the district court of Cook County conducted a hearing on a motion by the village of Skokie for a preliminary injunction. The court considered Collins' letter as an affidavit and took the testimony of a number of Skokie residents. One resident testified that a number of Jewish organizations planned a counter demonstration for the same day, with an expected attendance of 12,000 to 15,000 persons, and that the appearance of Nazi demonstrators could well lead to violence. So this is a heckler's veto. Now, I'm sorry if I have to use that designation to talk about people objecting to Nazis appearing in public, but it's the same objection used when people who are conservative speakers appear on college campuses today. Is it bad for Nazis to walk around and say things that are, you know, hurting other people's opinion? Yes, it's bad, okay? But it's not illegal. And the idea that it could cause violence from counter-demonstrators is not a sufficient reason to deny them a permit to demonstrate. The court entered an order enjoining defendants from marching, walking, or parading or otherwise displaying the swastika on or off their person on May 1st, 1977. The Nazi Party applied to the Illinois Appellate Court for a stay of the district court's injunction. The appellate court denied their injunction. On appeal, the Illinois Supreme Court also denied the petition for a stay. So the Illinois Supreme Court denied the position of these the petition of these Nazis for a stay of this order not to display their paraphernalia. The Nazi Party then filed an application for a stay with Justice John Paul Stevens, who referred the matter to the court. And John Paul Stevens, by the way, ended up being a liberal judge. after he was appointed. So the court did agree that the permit should not have been denied. Now there's one final case I want to examine. This is Snyder versus Phelps. Phelps, of course, is Fred Phelps, the head of the Westboro Baptist Church. It says the family of deceased Marine Lance Corporal Matthew Snyder filed a lawsuit against members of the Westboro Baptist Church who picketed at his funeral. The family accused the church and its founders of defamation, invasion of privacy, and the intentional infliction of emotional distress for displaying signs that said, think, well, I can't say this on YouTube, but it says U.S. District Judge, sorry for the troops, but I can't repeat this anyway. I'd get a strike. U.S. District Judge Richard Bennett awarded the family $5 million in damages, but the U.S. Court of Appeals for the 4th District held that the judgment violated the First Amendment's protection on religious expression. The church member's speech is protected, notwithstanding the distasteful and repugnant nature of the words. And the question was, does the First Amendment protect protesters at a funeral from liability for intentionally inflicting emotional distress on the family of the deceased? And the ruling again was yes, and it was an 8-1 decision. The only person who disagreed. So again, if you look back at the 1969 case, who was the person who you notice at the bottom here? You have Thurgood Marshall and William O. Douglas and Earl Warren. Three liberals ruled in favor of the Ku Klux Klan. And you can see here that in 2010, you have that across the spectrum, you have Scalia, you have Sotomayor, you have Kagan, and you have Ginsburg all ruled that the Westboro Baptist Church does have the right to protest at people's funerals and say awful and derogatory things. So I have here three precedents in the Supreme Court that would probably strike down any sort of law that Danny Danone or Alan Dershowitz or Shmuley Boteach, at the moment I think only Danone has asked for an actual law or prohibition of anti-Semitism. You can't ban it, not in the United States at least. You could maybe ban it in one of these other countries that doesn't have a First Amendment, that doesn't have freedom of speech. But the fact is that you can't make it illegal for people to hate you, and you can't make it illegal for people to say things about you that are cruel and unkind. So that's about it. That's what I have to say. What do you have to say? Put it in the comments below. Also, please like, share, and subscribe to the channel. If you want, you can also subscribe to me on BitChute. There's a problem right now where it's not mirroring the videos very often, but every once in a while it does. And you can subscribe to me on Minds.com at Chef Leopard and on Gab at Starscream85. And have a great night. Woman trying to catch a trick on